So the legendary scientist Albert Einstein famously told that, "I have no idea what weapons will be used for World War III, but I'm sure World War IV will be fought by stone and sticks." So let's get started. The book talks about World War when it starts in 2024. It will not be same like Hiroshima. The war can start in 30 minutes and the bomb will be 1000 times stronger, and the bomb will not be like an atom bomb there. It will be thermonuclear bomb. And instead of cold war, we'll be having nuclear winter. We ourselves after the war will be something like a fate of dinosaurs. Just put it into perspective, 1 megaton of thermonuclear bomb can wipe out the whole city. We are not following like chapter wise like we do it in other things. We try to make it in sections to give you some whole idea of what the book is talking about. Book talks about the sequencing of what each minute will happen when the world war happened. That may be of importance, but for that I appreciate you go through the book. But we try to take out the information or the most important parts of the book, and we are summarizing here. So from nuclear bomb to hydrogen bomb. Nuclear bomb is what, or fission bomb, that's what we use it in World War II. But nowadays we are into thermonuclear bomb, or another we call it hydrogen bomb or fission bomb. Put in perspective, Hiroshima or Nagasaki, that bomb, Hiroshima bomb, was able to kill 80,000 people. That was something like a 10 feet long, 9,700 pound, which is equivalent to 2,100 conventional bombs. That was there. But actually, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, that ended that war. Maybe because of multiple reasons. Why US created the bomb in first reason was because they were afraid of Germany will make that. And in another way, they put it in Japan. A lot of reasons it ended that war. But the point is that after the World War, deterrence or defending somebody, that was the strategy people were using, including US and another country. We have 9 nuclear countries. All the people were using deterrence or defense strategy, or something, put it simply, is that we will make our own nuclear weapon in such a way that if someone else attack us, that will be an option for us to defend ourselves. That was somehow a proper justification to create these bombs. So the first bomb in 1945 and all, US stockpile has increased in 1947 and all these things from 13 to 844. Nowadays, we are close to 5,000, 4,000 or 5,000 weapons with the US, around 6,000 with USSR or Russia. So that's how the count ended up now. But all these weapons has been created with a deterrent strategy or a defending strategy, or put it simply, self-protection strategy. Section 2, magnitude of horror in thermonuclear bomb. So as we mentioned, 1952 was somehow the invention of thermonuclear bomb and all. Even during the Los Alamos period, if you follow our book Oppenheimer and all, that time itself they were having a plan to create thermonuclear bomb. If we give you some idea about science here, the original atomic bomb, that was actually cutting an atom or fissioning or slicing an atom to just take out that energy. But nuclear fusion is actually combining the atom and creating that energy. So all of the things you can just come out with the equal terms square and all. But the point is that our fireball or energy source of our planet, sun, actually work in nuclear fusion. So we are going to recreate that sun scenario in a bomb, which is a hydrogen bomb. It's a two-stage mega weapon. For fusion to happen, actually high temperature is required, like a sun scenario. So it's a two-stage. First one, we'll create a scenario of atom bomb using nuclear fission so that it will be something like a high temperature area. In that area, we will create a fusion. So that way, it will be like billions of degrees of temperature. everything in the line of sight will be flammable, including metal, everything. The disaster will be 1,000 times Hiroshima bomb like that. Even 1952, US tested, they call Ivy Mike, and they tested in an island, the whole island disappeared. And 1961, I think, Russia tested, they call Tsar bomb, and that result of them, they themselves was become afraid of the potential of such a bomb. That is what we call it, thermonuclear bomb or hydrogen. Once this bomb is exploded, it will just create like a sun in the planet, and it will destruct everything what is available, and will create multiple explosion to explosion, and even everything what we thought about, it will be just disappeared like a barren land like that. You will be only left with some debris and skulls and all. That's how devastating that bomb is. Deterrence to distant attack. That's somehow a section we created. So as we mentioned, in 1945, the bomb was created, and the US, United States used US Air Force to deliver that. But nowadays, you don't need an Air Force to deliver a nuclear weapon. You can send a missile, and we'll come to that. So now, 9 countries are nuclear powerful. Whenever there is a war happening, like Russia-Ukraine war or Iran, wherever it is, there will be a point of talking about nuclear attacks and all. But in actual fact, 9 countries have nuclear capability, but out of that, only few can deliver using intercontinental missiles. We'll come to that. So first one, naturally, United States, then Russia, France, UK, China, India, Pakistan, Israel, and North Korea. I believe I come across all the 9. So the point is that they all created, as I mentioned, as a deterrent strategy, they created a lot of stockpiles of nuclear weapons. And all of this one is ready to launch as a part of deterrence strategy. Another way, they used to just test lot of these missiles just to make sure that their enemies know it, and they themselves know the power, and the enemies though know their power, so that also is considered like a deterrent strategy. Okay, don't attack me, I am powerful, something like that. Intercontinental ballistic missile, ICBM. So that is actually a carrier vehicle or a rocket or something which can transport a weapon, say for example, from China to US, from North Korea to US, in anywhere in the globe. So out of the 9 nuclear countries, only 6 of them have ICBMs. That simply means these are the people who can start the war by staying in their own country by sending a missile, ICBM, to those countries. So for example, as we mentioned, USA, Russia, China, India, and Israel and North Korea. So those people have UK, France, and Pakistan. They don't have ICBMs. So they cannot send it. They have nuclear weapons. That's the thing. It's true. But the point is that Russia have the longest one, 18,000 kilometers. Then India and US have 16,000 kilometers. India have 15,000 as well. And China and North Korea, they all have 15,000 kilometers. And essentially, that simply means like North Korea can send an ICBM to United States and then start the war. So the point is that once you send the ICBM to a country, suppose the North Korea send a missile to United States, it cannot be recalled. Simply mean they notice that there is an ICBM coming. One option is only to send an interceptor missile and at the same time send an ICBM to that country. That means the war is already started in 30 minutes. Maybe less than this video I'm recording or the what you're watching, less than that time a nuclear war and a retaliation or reconnaissance attack can happen. A space-based infrared system like SBIS satellite, that is what the United States have. Its only job is to check for ICBMs or intercept missiles happening all over the globe. That means, for example, in North Korea or any other country, send a missile to United States, that will be the first one to detect and tell this one. But the point is that even this satellite, you can launch an ICBM from land, from sea, from air, a lot of options are there. But the point is that it can only detect during the launch time. If you know the point, infrared, that means something related to heat mapping and all. So these missiles have multiple. It is launching time, trajectory, and terminal phase like that. So only during the launching time it can detect it. But the point is that most of the US ICBMs that are all static, but North Korea one, most of them are road mobile and all, you cannot send it. And something submarines also, it's very difficult. It is not easy to detect what is happening in the shallow waters and all. And another thing is that interceptor missiles, even though US have a lot of interceptor missiles, that cannot be completely guarantee all those things. Dripper drones are there. A lot of options are there to just prevent a missile. Like if you see recent Iran-Israel war, when Iran attacked Israel, they were using the interceptor system, the Iron Dome, and a lot of these things to blast it in the air itself. So similar idea they'll be using for ICBMs from other countries and all. But that completely cannot assure catastrophe happening. As I mentioned, nuclear weapons can be delivered through using ICBMs and all. But the point is that it has three phases. First one is a boost phase, then mid-course and terminal phase. So if you give you some idea, Russia need 26 minutes, I think. That was a calculation to send an ICBM from Russia to US. North Korea and China, it's almost same, like 33 minutes or 34 minutes. That's where we stand. Most of the countries announce when they're creating ICBM test, ballistic missile testing and all. But North Korea especially, they're not announcing it. They just do it. That's how the thing. And so also one of the reason, their programs are too much secretive. Even somebody used to tell that they just actually inspired from Russian nuclear program and then they created law. So their capabilities are unknown in that level of capabilities of their latest ICBM like Hwangsong 17, I believe, something like that. So that's all capabilities are not very much aware to the whole world. So what are the options when we have a war? Like satellites, first of all, submarines are there, fighter jets. So the point is that the US president have a famous, always they have a leather sachet, they call it football, and it has a black book inside it. It has all the instructions of all the hair trigger alert or launch on warning. So if a war is happening, everything there, like what are the weapons available if you use this, like something like a, you imagine like a game, it is giving you all the tools you have, like launching weapons, and then it will tell you what will happen to. So somehow, especially because of this ICBM is happening in 30 minutes and decision has to be taken, all these preconceived ideas have been given at their disposal at every time. So the point is that US have land, air and sea. In that one, in land they have 400 ICBM. In 66 they have it on fighter jets and all. And I think 16 they are available in submarines. But the point is that whatever is available in land, unlike North Korea, it is all static and it is not mobile. Like especially the citizens of US, they don't appreciate sending nuclear weapons here. And so most of them are hidden, secretive and static. And the author is somehow telling it's even available in the internet and all. I did not check it, but I'm just telling. So the point is that these are the three options available, and also for sure satellites and all. Out of this, the most efficient will be submarines. We'll come to that. Even though we only have, or US only have 16. Through air, we have stealth bomber. I'm telling we in the sense because the author is talking about US and all. But it doesn't mean that I'm representing US or I'm supporting US nuclear program or something. We are just doing it in a book summary perspective. Please take it in that way. So the point is that B-2 stealth bomber, 66 nuclear weapon, we can use stealth bomber and all, but the challenge is that on such long intercontinental attacks and all, stealth bombing, this B-2 flights and all, it require refueling, it's not practically completely, and it is detectable also, even though called stealth, somehow. But USS submarines like USS Nebraska and all, that is actually virtually undetectable. So submarines actually, they are something like a self-surviving ecosystem. It has everything available for unlimited time inside it. So when it is launching, it has just have to come to the waters, launch it and go down. So somehow it will be virtually undetectable. So that way it is so much powerful to strike in both parties. So also SLBMs, the time to launch can be also reduced. Like for example, you can pass through the oceans undetectable and reach to a country, and from there submarine launch ballistic missile, you can send it to a country. So I'm telling, when there is a war available, submarines will be just relocating themselves along with warships and other things. But submarines are very much like a threat for every nations from nuclear attacks. So United States have Aegis and Thor interceptor missile system on the land to send it. And along with that, they have space-based infrared and Proud Prophet radars and all to detect that something coming from the air. And also, as we mentioned, even though submarines and shallow waters are challenging, there is something called SOAS US or Sound Surveillance System. Even though it can detect most of the things, it cannot completely detect a submarine things and all. So that are the three, even and a missile is happening, that are the three somehow a defense system available as per the author. So we all talk about now how the nuclear war happened and all. Suppose what will happen after the nuclear war three, like what Albert Einstein initially told. So some of the effects are because of the war, the sunlight, the wind, the particles, nuclear particles in the air will somehow block the sunlight for a minimum of 10 years. And the whole troposphere of the atmosphere will be affected and the whole weather will be affected because of that. Extreme cold will be there in many continents like USA, Europe and Asia and all. And also crops will be devastated and Arctic sea ice will be expanded. So the seas will be or oceans will be converted to ice, so it will be like a nuclear ice age or little ice age or something like that will be happening there. And yes, naturally, survivors will face the radiation poisoning and all these things. Even in Los Alamos, there was an experiment, one of the scientists, he was having some moral issues and he tried to left the Los Alamos. So during that time, he was trying to teach that things to some other substitute person, alternative person and all. One of the nuclear, like a spear, actually fall from him and he tried to protect himself using the body. That radiation created, like he was able to survive only, I think, 9 days. But after he died, they tried to check his autopsy. That was really shocking. Like that nuclear radiation created something like a juice inside his body. That much devastating or powerful it was, the nuclear poisoning, radiation poisoning. And after the war, we'll be something like a dinosaurs, like human hunter-gatherers will be there. So because of the whole system is devastated, agriculture and food supply will be affected. Aquatic foods like ocean food, seafood, all these things will be affected naturally for sure. And along with that, there will be widespread famine happening there. And also, because of the war, the ozone layer will be affected. So that will also create a lot of ultraviolet radiation, which is not happening now. Even though we talk about less about chlorofluorocarbons and all, that nuclear war will be just affecting the ozone layer much and will have nuclear radiations and all. And only that what we call about dinosaurs. Dinosaurs was able to be just wipe out from the planet because they are big. So only the small animals like insects, they're all going to grow because the whole food chain is destructed. So some small organisms will increase more and that will actually create a lot of diseases spreading. Also, whoever is surviving there, they'll be affected by a lot of such diseases by the small insects and all. So the life on Earth will be so much painful. There will be a grand evolutionary shift happen. As I mentioned, the small organisms will increase more and all. And somehow the survivor face challenges to adapt and all. And to survive or to recover it back, it will take thousands and thousands of years. So something like what Albert Einstein was predicting, we will be using stone and sticks to war and will be living like our ancient ancestors after the nuclear world war. Until we come across with the next book, thank you for watching. Bye for now.